surely.
Oh, yeah. What's up, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to episode 26 of the Sailor Jerry podcast. My name is Matt Cawthron. I am still your host, and it is beginning to look a lot like Christmas. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, we are just 2 days away from December 25th. The holiday season is 100% upon us all. I hope everybody out there is happy and healthy and living their best motherfucking life. You know, I mean, I don't even know where to begin on this topic, on this episode. I got a lot of energy and a lot of ideas and thoughts floating around my head. So you're just going to have to bear with me for a little bit, you know. First things first, we got back from Buffalo, New York, you know, after a very successful musical mission at TID The Season, an annual concert event thrown by the band Every Time I Die out of Buffalo, New York. And man, oh man, was it a fucking blast. You know, we had both bands there, Mariachi El Bronx on night one, Friday night, and the Bronx proper on night two, Saturday night. And we got into Buffalo on Thursday night and hit the ground running. You know, so good to see the Every Time I Die dudes, and just to be back in Buffalo. It's a great city, a lot of great friends there. So we hit the ground running. We were hanging out. We put in some time on Thursday night, you know, catching up, as they say, having some drinks, having some laughs. And then Friday was, you know, let's just jump into it. I mean, it was the first El Bronx show in almost 2 years, you know. So the energy beforehand was definitely chaotic, you know, chaotic, but, you know, very exciting. And the crowd was unbelievable to us. We stepped out there, you know, I mean, we're playing, this is basically, you know, basically a hardcore festival. You know, it's like there's a lot of different bands doing a lot of different things, but for the most part, it's rooted in hardcore. So you can see hip hop, you can see a little bit of metal, you can see some punk, but mariachi music, not really, you know. So it is always kind of an interesting gamble when you go out there in an environment like that. You don't really know what's going to happen. But, you know, people were so stoked to hear the band, to hear something different. The crowd was absolutely unreal. You know, we played our hearts out. It went really, really, really good. It was an awesome night. You know, it was really cool to see a band like Circus Survive. I've never seen them before. Anthony Green has been a longtime friend of the Bronx. We go way back from the early days of recording Bronx demos in Bo Burchell's garage when Anthony was singing for Seozin. And you know, it was great to see him. You know, he's one of those guys that's just an incredible dude, an incredible talent. And I just never seen that band before. The band was really fucking good, man. So, you know, they played after we played. And then, of course, night one of Every Time I Die hits the stage. And I'll tell you what, man. I mean, there's a lot of stuff going on with that band behind the scenes. You know, I'm sure anybody who's a fan knows what I'm talking about. But they, man, did they channel that shit and just drop a bomb on everybody in attendance on night one. I mean, they were so good. They were so, so, so good. So, you know, and that was a lot. I mean, that could have been it. You know, that could have been it, but it wasn't. Night two, was next. And waking up, after night one, after Thursday night, getting pretty radical. You know, I'm not going to lie. I was, it took a little bit of rallying for your boy. You know, I needed to step up. We all did. You know, everyone was kind of feeling it a little bit. But at this level, ladies and gentlemen, the show must go on. And go on it did. The second day was another unreal day of performances, music, wrestling, all kinds of stuff. You know, people were having so much fun, taking care of each other. One of the big moments for me outside of the Bronx set, you know, the Bronx set, man, I wish I could properly find the words to explain what it feels like to go from El Bronx to Bronx. It's like 0 to 60, you know, but it's just, it's so much more than that. So, you know, the opposite vibe of night one, you know, nice, calm, cool, relaxed, everybody, let's smile, let's enjoy life and music and have a good time. To Bronx on night two, which was very much, you know, in your face. And it was incredible, man. I mean, once again, the crowd was there for us, really, really lifted all the bands up to a really enlightened place. You know what I mean? It was just something in the air. And it was really, really cool. The pit was pure insanity. People were crowd surfing and having a good time and singing along. So it was great. And then after that, you know, we come down from the high of playing music, you know, you come down to that. And then, ladies and gentlemen, one of my all-time idols, one of my favorite artists on the planet, the legendary West Coast OG Ice-T, performed an all hip hop set of just 100% classics. And I've never seen Ice-T do an all hip hop set. I've seen Body Count a bunch of times, you know, but seeing him, just rip it up and just talk shit to people the way only Ice-T can talk shit. It was special, man. It was special. Ice was so cool. I mean, it's a whole thing, you know, like he's backstage. It's like there's bands, you know, and then it's Ice-T. He's, you know, he doesn't have any reason to need to meddle with any other artist backstage. He's got Coco there. I saw Coco. Coco was looking fly as shit. It was awesome. But we're backstage, you know, and our guitar player, Joby, he goes, man, I got to do it. I got to do it. He goes into Ice's room, says, Ice, nothing but respect. Don't want to interrupt what you're doing in here. But we're from Los Angeles. We're big fans. Is there any way we can get a photo with you? And Ice was like, hell yeah, you know, it's all good. So Ice comes into the room and there's so many things I wanted to say to him, so many things, but you just can't. I mean, it all goes out the window when Ice-T enters the room. He comes in, he's like, what's up, fellas, you know? And he's just cool as shit, says what's up to everybody, takes a couple photos, hangs for a second and just says, you know, hey, keep at it, be safe out there, keep rocking, all just sorts of, you know, amazing, just one-timers, from the OG. And then he leaves, you know, and we're all standing in the room like, oh my God, I cannot believe we just motherfucking met Ice-T. So shout out to Ice-T. Shout out to Every Time I Die. Shout out to Tid the Season. Everybody who was in attendance, thank you for making us feel so good. Night two of Every Time I Die was the perfect closer, man. I mean, it was just awesome. You know, that band is really doing something special. You know, that's like I hope to God that they can get through everything they got to get through, you know, and keep going, because that's a really special band, a really original band, full of, honestly, I mean, you want to talk about a group of characters, I mean, they are all complete, individual, original, just amazing, amazing dudes. And I got to get up on stage and sing a song called The Sweet Life with the band on the second night, a song from, I think it's their fourth or fifth record that they were recording in California at some point. And I went over and sang a chorus on. So it was really cool to sing that song live. You know what I'm saying? So Buffalo was off the hook. Okay. You know, we get back. You know, it took a little time to recover. You know, it was just so much fun, man. It was so awesome. That's the official wind down for the year musically, you know? So now you get into this groove of like, okay. Like, it's cool. You know, the year's coming to a close. It's motherfucking Christmas time. I got a podcast to record, you know, let's knock it the fuck out. And then I'm sitting there thinking, holy shit. It's been 1 year of the Sailor Jerry podcast. I can't believe it. What an incredible honor this is for me to look back on over a year of podcasts. I was flying from the seat of my motherfucking pants, ladies and gentlemen, when this thing fucking started. I'll tell you what, you know, Dana Dynamite, my good friend. I just want to say before I kind of go down the full alleyway of memories here, big shout out to Dana, and thank you for trusting me to put this thing together and to host it. And I've had so much fucking fun. You know, you think that a podcast is just grabbing a fucking mic and just talking shit, and it is, but it isn't. There's so much work that goes into it, you know? So and that started with just laying it out. Like, what do we want to do? What do we want to say? You know, and a whole bunch of research goes into the back end of like, who, you know, who's going to fucking house this fucking thing? Where does it live? How do I get it on Spotify? How do I get it on iTunes? All that shit. So we laid all that shit out together and we just went for it. Episode 1, Howlin' Pele Almqvist from the motherfucking Hives. Shout out to my boy Pele for being the guinea pig, man. I mean, I did not know what I was doing, and I knew that, you know, Pele is the man, obviously. The Hives are the greatest rock and roll band on the planet. And I reached out and just said, hey, man, you know, do this with me, you know? And without even thinking, he said yes. You know, so shout out to Pele. And that episode was the one that launched it all, you know? And then Big Frida right after that. Shout out, Big Frida. You know, the queen of bounce. You know, that was kind of a nerve-wracking interview for me, you know, because, I mean, Pele was my friend, you know, but, and Frida, I mean, he's cool as shit, you know, I mean, it's super personable and super welcoming, you know, down to earth as fuck. Turned out we had a bunch of things in common, bunch of friends in common. We were off and running at that point. You know, Sarah Fable, amazing artist, first tattoo artist on the show. Shout out Sarah Fable. Wes Isol, number 4. The Wes episode was a big one for me because I really poured a lot of my heart and soul into the editing process of that episode. And getting him to read a poem live at the end of the interview was something I really, really wanted to do. And something that I was kind of, you know, nervous about asking him about, but he did it. He was down as fuck. And it was a really cool moment. So shout out Wes, Michelle Miles, tattoo legend, Daredevil Tattoo, New York. What a historian. What an amazing human being she is. Shout out Michelle. Matt Gondek, my buddy, incredible artist. What a year, couple years it's been for him. Exploding into the NFT space. Was really great to talk to him about music and art. Keith Buckley, going back to Every Time I Die. You know, Keith, that was another important episode for me. Great to actually talk to my friend about, you know, the writing process. And so much of this stuff is so cool, because even if you're interviewing someone that you know, or someone that you've known for a long time, you don't, for some reason, you don't have these conversations, you know? So it was really cool to kind of be able to ask him questions about his process, you know? And Keith is one of the funniest dudes on the planet. So, you know, that episode was a monster episode. Shout out to Keith, man. And then a double Keither, Keith Underwood, tattoo legend, Austin, Texas. What can you say about Keith Underwood? He's one of the funniest, grimiest dudes on the planet. You know what's great about Keith? Every year his family sends out Christmas cookies to people on their inside mailing list. And I got cookies from them about a week ago, and they were motherfucking delicious. So thank you, Keith. Graceland, you know, awesome up-and-coming artist from the UK. That was a really cool interview. You know, one of the things that was a goal on the podcast was to kind of highlight up-and-coming artists as well. You know, I mean, obviously we want the big fish interviews, but we want to be a spot where people can come to learn about up-and-coming artists, up-and-coming tattoo artists, up-and-coming musicians, up-and-coming, you know, anything. You know, it's not all about the top shelf. You gotta, every now and then, you gotta showcase the farm system. You know, you gotta show people what's out there that's coming up, you know, because that's a really exciting time, you know, to talk to people, to talk to artists when they're in it. Frank Carter, episode 10, you know, Frank Carter, I mean, he's the man, you know, tattoo artist, musician, incredible front man. You know, he's got Rose of Mercy tattoo shop in England. I think they just opened their second one. Shout out, Frank. I mean, he's got a new, the Rattlesnakes have their new album, Sticky, out, that came out this year. You know, Frank's the fucking man, always busy, always working, always creating. And then episode 11, Josh Barnett, got an ultimate fighter on the motherfucking podcast. Hell yeah. You know, that was fucking cool. Josh is a great friend of mine. We wanted to do something special around Fleet Week because it was just, you know, we were stuck in the pandemic and just wanted to do something cool. So Josh came on and really, really shed some light on the warrior spirit. And then we got Dan Lamb, episode 12, incredible artist, truly super unique artist. And it was really cool to talk to her, get insight on her process. Episode 13, man, Coe Wetzel. Coe Wetzel was a wild one for me because that was like out of my wheelhouse, you know? It was like pop country, bad boy, you know, hunter, partier, you know, but it was like super cool, you know? Coe was an awesome dude, down to earth. Really, really, really nice guy. And that episode came out great. So, you know, another one where I was super stoked to have the podcast, because it's like it turns into something you don't really expect it to turn into sometimes, you know. So shout out Co. Sergio Hernandez, a tattoo artist that I really love. What an individual that guy is. Super talented. Awesome dude. Bronx 2 anniversary episode. That's an episode Joby still doesn't think that I told him he was going to be on a podcast. but that episode was really, really fun to take a look back at 15 years of our second record with producer Michael Beinhorn and Joby J. Ford. Good motherfucking times. Rose Hardy, incredible tattoo artist. Alex Yanez, another incredible artist out of Miami. That was a really cool episode, the first episode on the road. And Rose Hardy was the first YouTube episode. We jumped into YouTube halfway through this year. And that was another thing we just kind of did by the seat of our pants. So, you know, thank you guys so much for rocking with us as we're kind of just building this thing, you know, literally from the ground up. Amel and the Sniffers, awesome, awesome episode, incredible band. Their new record, Comfort to Me, is a banger. If you haven't heard it yet, go listen to it. If you haven't bought it, go buy it. Jordan Buckley, episode 19, the other half of the Buckley duo. What can you say about those two? They're so different, but they're so similar. Shout out to Jordan, man. Great guy. Wade McNeil, Doom's Children record is unbelievable. If you haven't heard that, go check it out. Mary Joy Scott, man, she had some incredible stories about Ed Hardy, about her own tattoo journey. That was super fucking cool. Danielle Colby, American Pickers, Halloween episode. Come on, if you haven't watched that on YouTube, go check it out. And then 1, 2, 3, Jim Lindbergh from Pennywise, Dennis Lixon from Refused, and Brian Keeneland from The Bouncing Souls. You know, three absolute legends, in my world, at least, you know. So it was really great to sit down and talk to those guys about what they got going on. And, here we are now, ladies and gentlemen. I can't believe it. It's been 1 year officially. Sailor Jerry has been super cool to me. They sent me out this bottle with my picture on it and, a super sweet message on the back, just saying thanks for everything and for being a part of the SJ family and all that good stuff. So I want to take a moment to thank them for allowing me to do this, for giving me the opportunity to do this. It's been a lot of fun, man. It's been a lot of fun. And, we're just getting started. We got, a lot of room to grow and a lot of chaos to bring in the upcoming years to the podcast arena. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take this bottle of Sailor Jerry right here, 92 proof, by the way, bold and smooth as hell, made the old school way. And for the first time on the podcast, I'm going to pour myself a little drink in this badass tiki fucking glass that they sent me. Look at this. Boom. Right there, baby. We're going to go like this. And we're going to say cheers to everybody out there for rocking with the Sailor Jerry podcast for 1 year. I can't say enough how much fun it's been and how much I appreciate everybody out there rocking with us. So cheers to you. It's time for episode 26. Marina Inoue is a straight up incredible tattoo artist. In this episode, we talk about growing up wild and free in NYC. Moving to Richmond, Virginia to sharpen her skills as a tattoo artist, finding her own path, style, and voice as a female in a mostly male-dominated industry, the smiles and cries of social media, the zen-like focus and flow state of rock climbing, and why charity and community within the art world is a bigger picture worth talking about. So get out your chalk bag, pour yourself some Sailor Jerry, and let's go!
Bushels of fun. Now the jingle hop has begun. Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell rock. Jingle bells chime and jingle bell time. Dancing and prancing in Jingle Bell Square. In the frosty air. What a bright time. It's the right time to rock the night away.
Yo, what's up, Marina? How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing great. Really appreciate you taking the time to be on the Sailor Jerry podcast with us. I've been a fan of yours for a long time now. I actually caught your work on Instagram, of all places. That was probably, I don't know, I feel like it was at least 5 years ago now, probably long, way longer than that. But you know, where are you, let's start in the present. Where are you at right now? Are you in Salt Lake?
I'm in Salt Lake City. That's correct. Yeah. I just moved here March 15th, but I've been coming here for a long time, like a decade, coming to work with the people that I'm working with out here. So
awesome. And what shop are you at right now?
I work at Mercy.
Awesome. Awesome. Yeah. Salt Lake City is a really cool place. It's always, you know, growing up in California, it was always one of those places that was kind of, you know, there was a lot of mystery around it, you know, mm-hmm. and I think that touring kind of helped kind of smash some of those barriers down for me, at least. I mean,
sure.
It's a really beautiful place. There's a lot of great people there. You know, how do you feel about Salt Lake? Is it like, does it feel like home to you?
It's an interesting city. You know, I kind of knew what to expect because I'd been coming here for so long. Like by the time I moved here, I didn't really need to use GPS to get around anymore. I'd been visiting so much. It is really beautiful. And the shop that I'm working at is the best. I'm working with people who I consider my best friends, who I also consider like total inspirations. Everybody who works there is a killer. You know, they're all so good at tattooing and everybody really like pushes each other, which is amazing. It's like one of the best work environments I've ever been in ever. It's so fun. It's really great. The city itself is kind of weird. I mean, you know, there's like the Mormon thing that I think isn't as prevalent as some people might think in Salt Lake City itself. In the surrounding area, it's like, it's a whole culture. It's yeah. that I obviously don't relate to, but Salt Lake itself has like a pretty big kind of subcultural backlash to that. So people get tattooed a lot, which is cool.
So where did you grow up?
I grew up in New York City, in Manhattan. I'm like a full
what?
Yeah, full city kid. I was born and raised in Manhattan and was there till I was 25. So like all the way through into adulthood.
What was that like growing up in New York?
It was, you know, so I'm about to be 36. So I grew up kind of like at the tail end of the old New York, right as Giuliani became mayor and kind of like changed the city in a lot of ways. I mean, in my personal opinion, certainly for the worse. He's like a nightmare of a human being. But it was crazy, man. I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, I like got into punk really young, like was going to shows at like 13, you know. I just missed Coney Island High as a venue, but went to shows at like CB's, ABC No Rio, C-Squat, like all these like venues that don't really exist anymore. And like punk music was like a huge part of growing up. I was a bad kid. I was so bad. I was like totally ungovernable. I feel so bad for my parents, but it gave me a channel into like, you know, my life now. So
right on. Yeah. If you're going to be a bad kid, New York is a pretty great place to do it.
For sure. I acted out big time, big time.
That's right. That's awesome. Did you have any, you know, when did kind of art first happen in your life? What did your parents do? Was there any kind of artistic leanings that way, or do you discover it on your own?
Definitely. My mom is a freelance commercial photographer, still life. And my dad is he does graphic design and packaging design. It was like, commercial art is like in my, you know, blood or whatever. They were both like kind of like the generation before me, like New York, kind of like Lower East Side hipster types. They have an incredible record collection. They like hung out with all these weird like Lower East Side artists. That's how they met. I got into punk because my mom has like Sex Pistols records, you know, like that's how I got into it. So they like absolutely, I'm like so privileged in that way that I really never had a choice but to like get into the stuff that I got into, you know, like honestly, sort of much to their chagrin, I think they would have liked it if I had gone to college and had like a stable job that had benefits and health insurance and all that kind of stuff. Like, I think that that's what they wanted for me, because being freelance, while there's like ultimate flux, I mean, you know, as like a musician, there's like ultimate flexibility and freedom, but not a lot of like stability.
Yeah.
Yeah.
not a whole lot of stability. No. But so that's cool though. Did they kind of like, did they push you towards the arts at all? Or they just let you kind of, you know, find your own path?
They kind of just let me do my own thing. I'm an only child. Like a lot of kids that are from New York, I feel like are only children because there's just not space and nobody has money, you know? You either don't have money or you have a lot of money, but yeah, they just like, let me do my own thing. You know, they like encourage me in their own way, but never were like pushing me to take art classes or anything like that. Well, so my dad's from Japan, and he's pretty traditional. And so when I started getting tattooed, it was like not chill. he's like very progressive in a lot of ways, but still holds on to some of that like Japanese tradition where like people getting tattooed, especially women getting tattooed, is like pretty taboo. So, but he got over it eventually.
What was your first tattoo?
Ooh, I have a nautical star on the back of my neck that I got on St. Mark's when I was 14, like the year tattooing became legalized again. So like 99, maybe. Totally lied about my age. Nobody gave a fuck. And it's like, I still have it. It's not even covered up. It's so scarred that like, it can't be covered up. So I still have it. Yeah.
That's not bad. That's a good one. That's not too bad. At least it's on St. Mark's too.
I know.
I got my ear pierced once on St. Mark's.
Classic.
didn't really stay. It was on tour. It came out like a couple of days, but
yeah.
You know, it's all good. So how did art develop for you? You know, because did you start just illustrating or drawing, or how did you work your way into the tattoo world?
So I've always liked to draw. You know, I think I wanted to go to art school after I graduated high school. I wanted to do illustration or something like that, but the structure of school, I mean, it was like never going to be my thing. I do very poorly with one, authority, and two, like rigid structure like that. I like to learn, but in that environment it was hard for me, so I didn't go to school and I was just working. And Flywright in Brooklyn needed a shop role, and I'd been getting tattooed there for a while by Alex McWatt, and they needed a shop girl. And so I got hired as a shop girl and started working there. And that was sort of my like intro into the tattoo like shop world. I mean, I'd been getting tattooed for a while and like had seen tattoos on people through going to shows and stuff. And like, just like kind of always knew that that was something I was interested in. Like I wanted to be tattooed, you know, like immediately from a young age.
Yeah.
And so then I kind of like converged, you know, in my late teens.
Yeah. What was that transition like, you know, going from, you know, loving tattoos, getting tattoos, to actually, you know, attempting, you know, to become an artist that way? What, you know, is it nerve-wracking when you first jump into something like that? Because it's permanent. I mean, it's got to be. You know, it's like for me, you know, if I'm recording an idea, I can delete it. If it's, you know, I can delete it if it sucks. You know, like it's all good. You know, so I know that there has to be, you know, the learning curve with tattooing. You know, is something that really interests me, because you obviously really have to have a passion for it to get into it and to appreciate it and to take it seriously. So what was that kind of like, you know, kicking down the door process, so to speak, for you? What was that like?
Well, I, you know, this was like 14, 15 years ago now, or yeah, even longer, because oh my God. 17 years ago when I started working in a tattoo shop, that dates me so, so hard. I was 19 when I started working at Flywright. And it, you know, at that time, one, the internet didn't really exist. There wasn't really information out there like there is now. And two, you know, like the kind of like gate-kept boys club kind of mentality was definitely like the way that people would get into it if you were to like be, and I put this in quotes, respected, you know, or like have an apprenticeship that was to be like looked at as a respectable way to learn how to tattoo. It had already changed a little bit by the time I started getting into it. You know, women were a little bit more in the industry, slightly. But you know, it was a lot of work.
Yeah,
it was a lot of work. I worked really hard. And there's a lot of things I could say about it. You know what I mean? But I'm like very grateful to have had the opportunity that I did. There was definitely some missteps along the way on my part, you know, and definitely I think some like sort of like traditional style apprenticeship stuff that I think is extremely outdated and that I don't support anymore that I like had to go through. But you know, like gave me everything.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you find that you had to work twice as hard as a woman coming through?
You know, I don't know because I don't know what anybody else's experience has been like. I don't know what other necessarily, I mean, you hear horror stories. I've definitely heard stories of women having it very, very bad. My experience probably was different because I am a woman, you know, and there was definitely things that happened that like looking that were like traumatizing at the time specific to being a woman, you know, and definitely like mindsets that I had that were completely like internalized, like toxic masculinity and misogyny that I absorbed in order to like, I'm getting very like, I'm going off on a tangent right now, but that I absorbed in order to like survive and sort of assert my place in like this very male dominated and very white industry. You know what I mean? And looking back at that, like I definitely carry that as a weight around. If I could go back, I wouldn't do it the same way. But as an adult, you know, who's like in my mid 30s now, I can't undo it. And so my approach to it now is like taking that experience and making sure that not perpetuate it on other people, like other people who are around me who are learning how to tattoo. And, but also there's things about it that I like really appreciate, you know,
yeah,
for sure. And so maintaining those things, you know, taking the good parts that I like respect a lot and that I'm really grateful for, and then getting rid of the other stuff that was like whack.
Yeah, well, that's cool. I mean, that's something that's a, like a progressive way to look at it. You know, it's kind of like, you know, making your own impact on how you influence the community around, you know, which I think is really cool. Cause I mean, your work is incredible. It speaks for itself, but also, you know, you do a lot of awesome stuff for charity and community as well. You know, like I wanted to talk about the hand-drawn shirts you did, which I think were earlier this year, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, those were so sick. They were absolutely awesome. And,
Thank you. You
know, I know you do a lot of charity work and donate a lot of stuff that you sell online. Is that something that means a lot to you, you know, is just kind of making your art part of a greater good and kind of, you know, making sure that it gets out there in the community and goes somewhere else beyond someone's skin?
Yeah, I mean, certainly, you know, like at this point, my politics and the things that I care about are, you know, unapologetically woven into the fiber of who I am as a person, and who I am as a person is also like, you know, tattooing is part of that. And art seems, and tattooing seems like a frivolous luxury in a lot of ways, you know, but art in general is like one of the most like human things, and it's exclusive to humanity. You know, like it's like one of the most beautiful things about existing in cultures, like being able to have the capacity to create something that is like beautiful to look at and meaningful. And then tattooing is like so interesting because it's something that somebody carries with them for forever, you know, and tattooing has given me everything that I have. And it allows me to live in a way that is like really autonomous, you know, as autonomous as I can be in like this kind of society. And I think that using that privilege and that grace that I've been afforded to, you know, like help try to kind of change the landscape, and support people and support communities in the best way I can has become like very important to me.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome. I mean, it's really cool to see because that was honestly one of the things too, that, you know, with the last couple of years that everything's just been so crazy, there's been a lot of people doing really, really great things, you know, for the community and for people in need, you know. I wanted to talk about style for a little bit here because I love your style. To me, it reminds me, I grew up in East LA. So to me, you have like a, you know, an awesome traditional style, but it has like, it's got that perfect amount of neighborhood in it. It's just got that, like, it's got that just kind of gangster feel to it that I grew up around and absolutely love. So what does style mean to you? How do you approach, you know, getting your own creative juices out into your work?
Ooh, that's a complicated question. First off, thank you for your kind words. I appreciate it. It's been an interesting evolution. I mean, obviously my tattoos have changed so much over the last, you know, decade and a half. I think that this is probably the most I've ever felt like they reflect what I actually want them and have always wanted them to look like. And to be honest, a huge part of that was being in quarantine and being isolated. In the last, you know, a couple years ago, I mean, I was kind of already on this trajectory, but I had all this time to paint, you know, and painting had all these ideas, and this way that I wanted to start painting, which is to say that it's not very like tattoo-y anymore at all. I don't fuck with outlines. I don't really like mess with like traditional flash that much, or if I do, I kind of like put this other spin on it that makes it feel more like it's coming from me and less like it's coming like a reprint of something. And I think it takes a really long time to get to that point where you can like envision what it is you want something to look like and make it your own and then have it actually look how you're thinking about it in your brain. And it's taken me like 15 years, you know. But I really like, I love taking weird imagery, things that are not meant to be tattoo designs. And all of it is like pop culture regurgitation over the last like some odd centuries, you know. I always joke that like my real skill is taking something that already exists and making it look like something totally new. Like I'm not like a fine artist. I'm not like conceptual. I'm not really drawing things off the top of my head. I'm always looking for inspiration in different corners of like pop culture, you know, which is like part of the fun for me, part of the process for me. So like cartoons and postcards and weird things that I see driving alongside the road in gas stations. I'm always taking pictures of stuff. I use like my own photos as references a lot of the time, and like juxtapose them with other things that make it look totally different. I don't know. It's like really enjoyable for me. And doing black and gray is like really leaning into doing black and gray, but doing it in a super traditional way, but with non-traditional imagery has kind of like become something that I really enjoy
for sure. Yeah. Yeah, and you crush at it. I mean, it's amazing. Yeah, absolutely. What's up with color? You hate color or what?
No, I don't hate color. I do like it. And definitely there are some tattoos where like, I'm like, this needs to be in color for sure. But to me, like when I think about doing it, like say I'm doing a tattoo and then it's a cartoon, right? It's like maybe a Tex Avery wolf or something. When you do it in color, it looks like a cartoon. It just like, yeah. It looks like a sticker. You know what I mean? But then when you do it in black and gray and do this like really heavy black, it gives it to me and like the way that I'm perceiving it, it gives it this like weird, heavy, almost like moody, kind of like sinister feel to it, which is like amusing to me to kind of combine those two things. It makes it look serious. And it's funny to like make something as ridiculous as a Tex Avery wolf look very serious. So I enjoy it, but I do like to do color still. I just don't do it quite as much.
Yeah. I mean, it looks great when you do it, but yeah, I understand that completely. You know, it yeah. makes a lot of sense. I know you mentioned you kind of grew up, you know, on the punk rock side of life. I think I first came across your work. I don't know. Were you living in Richmond or maybe it was just, okay. Yeah. Cause that's, I think the first time I came across your work and yeah. Richmond is, it's an awesome city, you know, for punk and hardcore, especially. Yeah. You know, when did you kind of leave New York?
So I left New York, I think I was like 24, 25, and I moved from New York to Richmond, Virginia. And I ended up there because there was a crew of people who had moved to New York from Richmond, and I was working with them at, you know, they were like working in tattoo shops and stuff, and we all became friends. And I went down to Richmond on a 4th of July, and I was like, oh, the city is very fun. Very fun. And I was like, definitely into like hardcore at the time, for sure. And there was like a ton of bands that were kind of coming out of there and out of Baltimore and DC and stuff.
Yeah.
And it was just like, it felt right. And it was so fun. I probably could have stayed in New York for forever and would still be living there if I hadn't moved to Richmond and would have been fine. But I'm glad that I did. Like, moving to Richmond definitely changed my life in a lot of different ways. And I lived there for 3.5, almost 4 years. And in that time I did start climbing. And then that very much changed my life. After that, I was like super focused on climbing and traveled for like 6 months around climbing and tattooing, and then lived in Colorado for about 8 months, and then was on the road for 7 years. Yeah.
Damn. What were you doing? Yeah. Just traveling and tattooing and climbing?
Yeah, I would like go climbing for big chunks of time, like a couple months at a time, and then usually go back to Richmond and work in a couple other areas. Like I was going to Chicago once a year and coming to Salt Lake a couple times, but mostly going back to Richmond to work, and then climbing again for a couple months, and then working and climbing, and just like repeating the cycle kind of over and over for a long time. It was more like 5 years full time, maybe 6 years full time. And then 2020 happened and I still wasn't living anywhere. I didn't have an apartment. I was like bouncing in between different places, and that kind of broke me of it because I was forced to be like kind of static but didn't have a place to live, and it was like I was over it, and so yeah. I ended up in Salt Lake. I needed like a place to land for sure.
Yeah, that it wears thin after a while, you know. It's like you even like, you know, it is so nice just being able to, you know, go where you want to go. But I think everyone kind of hits a point that lives that lifestyle, hits a point where it's just like, okay, I need something. Totally. I need a nest at some point, somewhere, you know. Let's talk about climbing, because I'm super interested about that, because I want to know how you got into it. And I think it's really interesting how, you know, there's always kind of an outlet for creative people, a place to kind of where their mind can go and just concentrate on something else. Obviously climbing is a big deal. I mean, it's kind of like tattooing in a way where it's permanent. Mm-hmm. If you fuck up, you know, some bad shit's going to happen, you know? So, How did you get into it and how deep are you? Because obviously people out there listening, you know, we're talking about the recreational climber that might go on a date to some climbing place, you know, versus, you know, free solo, you know, that type of thing. So on a scale of 1 to 10 on rock climbing, where do you think you're at right now?
Probably like a 8.
Whoa.
Ish. 7.5 to 8. Yeah, I would say. I'm far beyond recreational, but not definitely not at the level of Alex Honnold and free solo. But closer to that than to recreational, I would say.
That's terrifying to me. So how this is a dumbass question, but how high have you climbed like on your own with no rope, with like just ground underneath you?
Oh, not that high. I mean, okay. So here's the thing. Height isn't necessarily the determining factor for accomplishment.
Okay.
It depends what kind of climbing you're doing. Difficulty. So like some of the hardest things I've done, some of the things I'm the most proud of have been very low to the ground, but very, very physically difficult. So there's bouldering where you're climbing on these boulders that are like maybe at most 15 feet high. There's sport climbing where you're clipping into gear that is hanging on the wall already. And, you know, that can be anywhere from like 40 to 50 feet to like 150 feet. And then there's trad climbing, which is like a whole other thing. And then there's multi-pitch climbing, which is like thousands and thousands of feet. So I've done like a 13-pitch rock climb in Squamish in Canada, but it was not hard for me. That's, but it was a lot of climbing. It was a full day. It was, you know, like a big day for sure.
It's beautiful, but as far as there.
It's so gorgeous. British Columbia is like magic.
We did a festival, a random festival up there, Squamish Festival, and
In Squamish.
I couldn't believe. Isn't it crazy up there? Oh my god, it's so beautiful. I could not believe it. It was just like they put this stage up in the middle of paradise and you're just you're just hanging out. Unbelievable. So what got you into climbing? What do you get out of it?
So my friend Matt Nolan took me to the climbing gym in Richmond just one day randomly. And I was like, oh, this is so fun. It appealed to like my, I don't know. I just like immediately thought it was cool. And I didn't really do it again for a while. And then I went on a couple road trips. I like went sightseeing in Yosemite, went sightseeing in Moab and Utah. And that kind of was what changed me, where I was like, oh, I don't ever want to be kind of in these places and not be able to like interact with the landscape in a really like close way. Like hiking wasn't doing it for me, you know, anymore. Yeah. So I started going to the gym a lot in Richmond and then started climbing outside in West Virginia, which is still a place that I love to go climbing. What do I get out of it? Oh man. I mean, that has changed a lot. You're actually asking me this question at a time where I'm like kind of taking a little bit of a step away from it. But what I like, the broad answer to that is, first off, being outside is really good for people. It's good for me. It's good for like my head. It's good for my like emotional interior. It's like amazing to be able to spend all this time outside in all these beautiful places. It's the sun, the air, the mountains. It's great. Two, it both keeps me extremely physically fit, also on the precipice of injury constantly, but it's good for your body in a lot of ways, you know, bad for your body in others, but I have like a lot of gratitude for what my body is capable of. It also like allows me to not think about anything for a while, you know, while I'm climbing. You get into this flow state that people talk about with sports psychology. And, you know, sometimes it comes and goes. Sometimes I'm more stressed than relaxed, but the correlation between moving your body and having all this muscle memory and having this like kind of like meditative dance happening while you're exerting an extreme amount of like physical and mental, you know, exertion is very sick. It's really cool. Climbing is amazing. Currently I'm having a funny relationship with it having to renegotiate how I'm feeling about it, taking a step back, doing Muay Thai. I'm a beginner Muay Thai person now, which I love. And it's nice to be like a beginner again at something, you know, with like zero expectations. So I'm switching it up a little bit, but it is something that I love so dearly, for sure. It's given me a lot.
Nice. That's really cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I was super excited to ask you about that because, it looked pretty serious, you know?
Yes. And, I'm serious about it for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. It's all, mm-hmm. and it's one of those things, at least for me, where it's like, I can't even imagine myself doing that. It just seems so gnarly, you know? And it's like, it's crazy. So props to you for doing that. And I understand taking a break too. You gotta, you know, you gotta space everything out. So who are some tattoo artists that you love and respect?
Oh my gosh. So many. First off, everybody I work with, everybody at Mercy is amazing. So it's me and then Jake Miller, who's one of my oldest, dearest friends, it's amazing to watch him work. Mina Aoki, who's like a fellow, we actually get mistaken for each other a lot. We're not the same person. But she's amazing and it's been really cool to work with her. Andy Canino, who I worked with in Denver back in the day. John Raftery, who I've known for a long time, and Brad Stevens are all people I worked with before as well. So it's kind of like this old, I've worked with everybody in the shop before, and now coming back to them, it's been like amazing and really inspiring to work around them. Outside of the shop, man, Brian Bruno and Mike Rennie, two of my favorite tattooers who I worked with in Richmond. Brian did my back and I've been tattooed by Mike too, and they're two of my favorite people. Greg Whitehead, also one of my favorites. Tamara Santi Banez, they're one of my favorite tattooers too. I'm constantly inspired by them, not only their work, but also what they do outside of tattooing is like really powerful for me. Oh, there's so many people, there's so many good tattooers now. How do you even begin to, like, I'd have to like go through my Instagram feed to see, you know, there's just like so many good people now. It's cool. It's exciting.
Yeah. I appreciate you naming some off. That's awesome for people to check out. What do you think about social media? Cause in certain areas, obviously it can be, you know, divisive and all that stuff. But fundamentally, I think for artists, it's an insanely, you know, awesome tool to get your work out to people who've never seen it and be able to communicate with customers, with clients, with other artists, all that stuff. There is, I think, a lot to someone being more than one dimensional on, you know, on social media nowadays. I think it's really cool for people to get an insight behind what their favorite artist or musician or whatever kind of believes in and stands for. Do you think, you know, social media is a positive tool? Do you look at it as something that is something you have to do for work, or do you enjoy it? You know, how do you feel about it?
Well, this is a whopper of a question. I mean, you know, here's the thing. Everybody knows it sucks and everybody knows it's great. You know, I'm learning continuously, as I think a lot of people are, how to experience both of the things at one time. It's like total chaos, you know, on there, and then it's total chaos that's completely orchestrated by these weird algorithms and designers and people who are pumping all this stuff out in order to get a particular kind of reaction, yada yada. Everybody's watched The Social Dilemma. That part aside, from like the nefariousness of it, not to sound like a conspiracy theorist, but it just is like marketing, you know. I wouldn't be able to live the way that I'm living without it. Yeah. It's like an online portfolio, you know, and then it's like not only an online portfolio, but you also get to like curate what it is you put out there and like who you're appealing to. And you can like make announcements, travel dates, all this stuff. So for work, it's unbelievable. As far as like actually using it to share information, that can get kind of dicey sometimes for sure. But I think it's also really useful, you know, like obviously Instagram or TikTok, I don't even use TikTok. I'm too old for it.
Yeah, me neither.
I don't understand it, but it's like very confusing. But like it can't be the only source of news, but sharing information, I have seen it do such powerful things. Like if somebody needs help and people ask for help for that person on the internet, that person can really get the support that they need, especially through a time like the pandemic. Like the amount of funds that I saw being shared and the amount of information that I saw being shared in 2020 was really, really powerful. And it was really like changing, life changing for me. Of course, people, you know, things come and go in waves. And so now nobody gives a fuck about any of that stuff anymore, which is disheartening to see. However, for me personally, it has like changed my perspective on how people are willing to help other people and how I want to continue to walk through the world and the things that I care about. And it was like, it's really powerful. It can be really powerful when utilized in a way that is for like, you know, the common benefit. The fact of the matter is like, this is the reality we live in, you know, like Instagram, whatever, whoever uses Facebook, older people use Facebook, younger people use TikTok. I don't know, all the things. It's like our reality. So to try to like be a Luddite is ridiculous. You know, like you can't really exist and be relevant in whatever it is you're be relevant in without it. It's like a weird, shitty, necessary evil, but you know, I don't know. I have to take breaks from it sometimes. I got to step away from it. I run 3 different accounts. It's like a total nightmare.
Oh,
I know, it sucks. And so sometimes I like, you know, my investment in it comes and goes and you see your like engagements drop and rise and people liking stuff. And I just have to not give a fuck about any of that. Like I'm busy and I'm sharing the things that I want to be sharing. And that's all I can like really care about.
Yeah, it's a lot. I mean, I think it's that, you know, it like, especially if it's a tool that you use for work and it's like, you know, cause with me, it's the same. I got my own, I got the bands, we got, you know, we all kind of use the band stuff and all that thing, but it's just, you know, like I found myself the other day, you know, once you start, like thinking about it, like you're like, actually it's like, oh,
it's, man, a bummer.
It's such a bummer. It's such a bummer. Yeah. You're like thinking, you're like talking to yourself. You're like, oh my God, what is even happening right now?
Dude.
But in that, you know, like in that way, it drives me insane. I hate it because I'm like, you know, I won't even go into all the things that pop into my head when it comes to social media, because it's so funny. Like I find myself, oh, I'm posting too much about work. I should post more about, you know, regular life. And then it's like, well, I'm living my regular life. Why do I, you know what I mean? You go back and forth with these things. But yeah, it is an incredible tool, you know, for work and all that stuff. So what do you think about, you know, art outside of tattooing? You know, as I know you were painting a lot during quarantine and stuff like that. Do you have any goals for yourself artistically outside of tattooing?
Me and Mina actually just got an art studio here in Salt Lake, which is the first time I've ever had a designated studio to work. It's so great. And I'm working on a big painting now. It's giving me a lot more space. I love tattooing for sure, but it's not everything to me like it is for some other tattooers. And I really like to make other things. I really like to paint in the way that I like to paint. I like doing those t-shirts that you mentioned. They give me a lot of like flexibility and freedom, and it's fun for me. I just think I want to like continue, you know, finding different sources of inspiration and like moving, you know, progressing and moving forward in that way. I would love to learn how to oil paint again at some point, maybe. I don't have the time at the moment. But you know, like as far as like other people's art outside of tattooing, I don't look at tattoos that much, and I don't look at tattoo art, specific art, that much. Like I find other kinds of art really inspiring, more so than like tattoo, very specific tattoo related art. So I like to go and look at other things for sure. It's like exciting to see. I love going to like galleries and art museums and stuff, and you know, furniture's interesting to me too. Like all, yeah. I love aesthetics in general, you know, like I draw inspiration from all kinds of things and try to like bring it back to my own stuff in whatever weird way. But
awesome. Yeah. Is there any travel plans for you coming up? Are you going to be you know, taking it on the road anytime soon?
Oh, I don't know. It's for some reason travel still feels kind of weird, though. I've been doing it. I'm going back to New York for Christmas, and then I'm going to be in Richmond in January and kind of in and out of California a little bit, and just kind of like playing it by ear, you know. Yeah. I feel like there's a lot of places I need to go and work. I haven't been to Chicago in a long time. I haven't worked in California in a long time. I haven't been to the Pacific Northwest in forever. Like, I don't know. There's all these places I want to go that I should go, but
yeah, life is, yeah, you should.
Oh, life is a lot though. You know what I mean? All of a sudden it's like, yeah, 5 years later and you're like, I haven't left my house, I guess, but
yeah, I know. We were able to go on tour this last year and it felt so good to get out, but it was still really weird. It was weird, you know.
I know, but it's, yeah, everybody has to recalibrate kind of, and COVID's certainly not over, but
yeah,
life goes on, you know. I don't know.
Life goes on. I think it goes on. I think it goes on. We'll see.
Sometimes, unfortunately, but
right on, Marina. I appreciate your time. Yeah. You know, and you know, I just wanted to ask you, you know, what at this point in your life, you know, you've done a lot, you creatively, you know, 36 years old. You grew up in New York City. You've lived all across the United States. I'm sure you've gained some perspective along the way. What does life mean to you? What's it all about?
A simple closing question, huh?
Yeah. Nice and easy.
I don't know. I don't know what it means in the broader sense. For as long as I have left on this earth, I'm just trying to do my best. You know what I mean? I want to be able to walk through the world in a way that I feel like reflects who I am as a person, you know, and like continue to grow. It's a constant process and will be, and oftentimes uncomfortable. But that's where like the most growth happens. You know, I'm like trying to always self-reflect and just do my best, you know.
Just trying right to on it. Yeah. Yeah, I appreciate your time, Marina. Thank you so much.
I appreciate
much.
You too. Yeah, thank you. It's been an honor. It's been fun.
Oh, no, the honor's all mine. Appreciate it. All right, Marina, peace.
Bye-bye.
Oh yeah, that's a wrap on episode 26 of the Sailor Jerry podcast, ladies and gentlemen. As always, huge thanks to our special guest, Marina Inoue. Marina, thank you very much for your time and the conversation. Really appreciate it. Amazing person, amazing artist. You can follow her at Marina_Inoue, spelled Inoue. That's her tattoo Instagram. If you want to follow the rock climbing Marina, it's Marina_Inoue, Inaway. So pick your poison there, ladies and gentlemen. I would just follow them both and be done with it, you know. So here we are, the end of 2021, one full year of the Sailor Jerry podcast. Thank you guys so much for rocking with me, for rocking with us. Thanks to all my guests this year. 1 through 26. It's been an incredible journey, to say the least. I've learned a lot and I've had so much motherfucking fun. So you can follow Sailor Jerry at Sailor Jerry. You can follow me at 213 Mattman. Don't forget that Sailor Jerry Spiced Rum is made the old school way, 92 proof, bold and smooth as hell. Also, don't forget to leave a little drink out for Santa as he's coming through the neighborhood. That's all I got for now, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you in 2022. Shout out to my old vocal coach, Ron Anderson, who passed away the other day. An incredible talent, vocal coach to everybody from Axl Rose to me. So an absolutely incredible human being, an incredible life, you know, doing the Lord's work, helping people save their voice and be confident in what they're doing. So thank you, Ron. You meant a lot to me, my brother, and you will be missed. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll see you on the flip side. Peace.